As we begin this holy season of Lent, let's consider how the angels act in our life, what their role is. Because as we hear in today's gospel, Jesus went out to the desert to fast and to be tested, and there he was ministered to by angels. So what do they do for us in our lives? Well, and what do we know about them? Well, we know for sure that they are spiritual beings and that this is a truth of our faith, and so we should not disbelieve them or doubt them or ignore them. And we should be very careful where we get our sources of information about the angels, because today there are many books written that are not written by Catholic authors, and some of them are rather New Age, and they have erroneous or difficult or wrong things in them. So here are some things that we know about the angels. We know that they can take visible form, even though they are spirits. We know this because we read it in the scriptures. In the Old Testament, the book of Tobit, Saint Raphael appears to Tobias and to help him out. In the Gospels, at the Lord's resurrection, there are two angels seated in the tomb, and at his ascension, when everyone looks up to see the Lord ascend into heaven, they look down again to see two angels visible. And for the most part, though, they act in our lives in invisible ways. The angels have a higher form, a higher nature than we do. In the order of creation, they are the highest. So there's inanimate objects and plants, animals, us, and then angels. And because of that, they are much smarter than we are, and they are much more powerful than we are as well. And God created them to give himself glory and to do his work, as well as for their own happiness. We know that there is an immeasurable amount of angels. There must be more angels than there have ever been people, or are ever people, or will ever be people. There are many, many. One church father said that the number of the angels exceeds that of the stars in heaven, or of the grains of sand on the seashore. And all of them are not equal. They are ranked into 9 different categories, or what we call choirs. They have a certain hierarchy. And sometimes we hear about these in the sacred liturgy, especially during the end of the preface. Sometimes it talks about thrones and dominations and principalities and powers. And we're like, what are that? What's that? Well, those are the different types of angels. They were all created together at the beginning, and they were all made good, but they were given a time of testing in which they were offered the chance to serve God or not. And the angels who refused fell away from God, and they are what we call the devils or the demons or the fallen angels. And they are the enemies of our salvation because they are fallen, and they want us too to be dragged down with them. You know, they say misery loves company. And that's why the evil angels want our destruction. The holy angels who remained faithful to God were admitted to the beatific vision. We know this because Jesus said it. He said, "Do not despise these little ones, for I tell you, their angels always see the face of my Father who is in heaven." And we know that angels are sometimes depicted in art in different ways, sometimes as children, because they are immortal, and therefore they are forever young. Sometimes they have wings, like they do in these two statues that we have in the sanctuary, which represent the swiftness with which they move and the promptness with which they carry out God's will. Sometimes they are pictured with lilies or other flowers in their hands to represent their spotlessness. And sometimes they're playing harps, as if that's all that they had to do. But that represents that they praise God. Sometimes they are depicted without a body, as only a head and wings. And I don't know if you've noticed, but we have 6 of them in the sanctuary here at the bottom of these red pillars. They're little faces with wings on them. And this represents that they are simply intellectual beings. They don't have any bodies. The holy angels are exceedingly beautiful and full of splendor. In the book of Revelation, St. John sees an angel in its full splendor, and he thinks it's God himself, and he falls down on his face, and the angel says, "Get up, I am only a creature like you are." So even when they do appear to us, they hide their glory so as not to overwhelm us. And the angels will be our companions in heaven, and that is why they take such great care of us on earth. They minister to us as they ministered to the Lord. And so we know that we each have a guardian angel because God, in his fatherly care, wanted to take care of us. Imagine, you know, as a parent, if you were to send your child on a journey through a difficult or challenging land or a dangerous land, you would want to entrust them to someone very powerful and trustworthy. And so God our Father has given us the angels to protect us and lead us safely to heaven. So what kinds of things do the guardian angels do for us? Well, first of all, they ward off dangers to body and soul. And all of us could tell stories about times when we should have been harmed and we weren't. And that is the work of the holy angels. But more importantly, they are to take care of our spiritual good, of our spiritual souls, and not only our bodies. And the happiest day in the life of the angel was when we were baptized and our souls were made clean. The angels, our guardian angels, also keep the evil spirits away. They guard us from the temptations and the thoughts that can come into our minds. And they can remove occasions for sin from us and help us to stay strong and overcome temptation. They also instruct us. And we see this in the Bible too. When at Bethlehem, the angels appeared to the shepherds and said, "Go to see the newborn king." Or on the day of the resurrection or the day of the ascension, the angels instructed those who were present. And that's what they do to us, except they don't appear most of the time. They work through our imagination and even in our dreams. We hear that Saint Joseph, that the angel appeared to him in a dream to tell him what to do, and sometimes the angels work in our dreams as well, either to give us holy and salutary thoughts or at times to remind us of God's judgment. They also pray for us and with us. And they offer our prayers and sufferings to the throne of God, and they witness our good acts, and they can correct us if we should happen to fall into sin, allowing trials and sufferings and temptations to come our way to humble our pride and to warn us of our complacency. You know, a few years back, Pope Benedict, before he was retired, I remember he fell and broke his wrist, and then he got up and said, "I think my guardian angel was teaching me a lesson." And they do that. They want what is for our good. And finally, they help us at the hour of our last agony, at the hour of our death. They strengthen and console us. And then after this life is completed, they take our souls to heaven. Or if we are to go to purgatory first, they go with us to console us. And the guardian angel at that point goes around and inspires our relatives and friends and good souls to pray for us and to offer masses for our sake. So they do this and much, much more. And we will never know fully all that they have done for us until we go to heaven, until we reach eternity. And then we will see exactly how hard they had to work. Some of our angels probably work harder than others, to keep us safe and to protect us. And so we ought to thank God for the gift of our guardian angels. We should have respect for their presence. We should have a devotion for their loving service. And we should have confidence because of their protection. Because, once again, they are a great gift. And they help us go through this difficult life to the joys of heaven. So we ought to always thank God about that, for that. And then, as a small addition to my homily today, Bishop Kimmy has asked that this Sunday be named Safe Haven Sunday, as we have in the last several years. And it's just our yearly encouragement to safeguard our families and our homes against all sorts of dangers, especially the danger of pornography that can wreak so much havoc in individuals' lives and in the lives of our families. So I just want to offer two suggestions. First of all, a spiritual one. Because there are so many angels, the church fathers say that there are angel guardians of countries, of cities, of parishes, of religious houses, and we can imagine that there are guardian angels for Christian families as well. And we can ask those angels to protect us and protect our families and to guard our homes against evilness and protect us against the snares of the devil. And then secondly, as a practical thing, we have to make sure that every single device in our home is safeguarded and protected and monitored. And if that's not possible, or if that's not working, then we ought to offer those devices the ultimate solution. So for example, if it's a television, we take it outside, and we stand about 10 feet away from it, and we blast it with a 12-gauge. Or a rock, if you don't have one, or a hammer, or whatever it takes. Because Jesus told us that if your eye causes you to sin, pluck it out. And if your hand causes you to sin, cut it off. And he wasn't saying that we should maim ourselves. He was saying we have to be serious about things that lead us to sin and remove them from our lives. It's better to go into life without a television or go into heaven without a phone, a television, whatever it might be, than to not go to heaven. And so let's ask the angels to protect us and to protect our families and to help us to lead holy lives so that we might one day be with them in eternity.